She dared to tackle Australia's untold history.
I felt like if there was anything that I was sort of put on the planet to do, it was do that series. It was an opportunity to really tell a comprehensive story of what happened in Australia from the perspective of Indigenous people who were there at the time.
She changed attitudes and perception.
A common response we had to First Australians, you know, why didn't we know about William Barak and his people and his land rights struggle? Why didn't we know about Windjedine and Pemulwuy and Bennelong?
She dared to push boundaries.
We don't just have to know about the gold rush, you know. We don't have to just know about Ned Kelly. You know, there's a bigger story to be told. There's a bigger Indigenous story.
And she dared to confront past wrongs.
You know, you couldn't go into pools, you couldn't go into bars, you couldn't get a hotel room if you were Aboriginal. There were curfews in town, you had to be out of town by a certain time. You know, we can't pretend that that didn't happen.
The daughter of the late prominent activist Charles Perkins is shining her own light on Indigenous issues.
It's like activism in Indigenous Australia has sort of changed. Like, we used to be out on the streets a lot, marching and protesting, and now we've sort of infiltrated government, infiltrated the arts, and we're using those springboards to be activists. And in a way, I feel like I'm a cultural activist.
Filmmaker Rachel Perkins joins me on Living Black Conversations. Rachel, thanks very much for joining us.
Pleasure.
You've made a name for yourself as a multi-award winning director and filmmaker of Australian Indigenous stories. What's been the driving force for you in sharing those stories about Australia's First Peoples?
Well, I was trained at a very early age at the Central Australian Aboriginal Media Association in Alice Springs. I started there when I was 18. And Frieda Glynn, who was the boss of that organisation, really, you know, gave us this vision that she had that Australians could understand Indigenous culture through television and film, and that was a medium to get into their houses and to touch them. And I think, you know, growing up and knowing so many non-Indigenous people and other Australians who didn't know about Aboriginal culture and hadn't shared it, like most Australians have very little contact with Indigenous people, I just thought that's a great way to harness this medium and give understanding to people who have no understanding of what it means to be Indigenous, the history of our people.
And Rachel Perkins is conquering the big screen, becoming one of Australia's most influential filmmakers.
Rachel is an amazing, amazing director. In my mind, I think she is one of our best directors in the country. What I love about Rachel is she has a fearlessness in the way that she approaches her work. She's got a great balance of vision, and integrity and heart and bravery. And she just knows how to create an environment where you feel safe. I trust her.
Rachel Perkins brings a lot of passion, a lot of heart, and a lot of truth, and a lot of culture, and a lot of, you know, she's walking, you know, the footsteps that, you know, her father, you know, fought for, you know, and we are in this medium that we can. We have the power to tell stories, and she understands that very well.
Rachel made her mark in the Australian film industry in 1997 with her first feature film, Radiance. But it was her telemovie Mabo, highlighting one of Australia's historic landmark court decisions, which captured the attention of the nation.
Mabo was one of your films which told the story of one of Australia's landmark court cases. How did it feel to reenact such a vital story that changed the, you know, the course of our future?
Making Mabo was a terrifying undertaking because it is such an important story. And as an Aboriginal person, it has great resonance for me, but it's from a Torres Strait Islander culture. So I had to, you know, immerse myself and learn about this distinctive culture, the people of Murray Island, Meriam people, and that was a big learning curve. But luckily we had the Mabo family working side by side. Koiki's wife Benita is still with us. She worked with us along the process. Gail, their daughter, was very close with us. And then we had the Passy family, Charles Passy, who was one of the other claimants, propelling us forward as well. So it was a great honour. I mean, we were sitting on Mer, and we were sitting on the block of land, the Passy land, which is the house that we were staying in, Charles Passy's father's house, who is the last surviving claimant. And we stayed in his house during the filming, and I just felt, what a privilege. Here we are sitting on this area of land that changed the whole recognition of Indigenous rights to land in this country. And here I am sitting here on this land with the people who changed it, and I'm telling this story, and what an incredible privilege. And oh my God, I hope I don't get it bad, you know, I hope I don't do a bad job. So that was a high point in my life, just meeting those people and working with them and being given that opportunity to tell that story. You know, everyone knows Indigenous people were here first. Everyone knows that, we can't pretend that. Other Australians felt guilty about living this lie that they were here. Mabo, in a way, released people from that. No longer did they have to feel like this, living a lie as an Australian. At least they could feel like, finally, our government and our court has recognised Indigenous people, so I don't have to, you know, as a non-Indigenous person, I don't have to carry that guilt with me into my life, or that lie, live that lie. So I think that's one of the important things about the Mabo decision, and that's one of the important things that Koiki, Eddie Mabo, understood that the case was about.
For me, I felt like Rachel was the perfect person to tell the story of Mabo. Being the daughter of Uncle Charles Perkins, she's grown up in that household that is a family of leaders. And that's how I see Rach too, in many, many ways, in terms of the work that she does. She's created many firsts in regards to filmmaking. And it just seemed to make sense that Rachel would take on the story of Mabo.
What was it like working on the set with Benita? And you know, I'm sure there were some special moments during that time on the set making it.
Yeah, it was incredible having Benita with us, and I think Deb Mailman, who played Benita, was almost overwhelmed with playing that role because she's such an important lady. And so Benita was on set and Deb was playing her, and there's a great moment this year at the Logies. Deb was nominated for Mabo and Benita was sitting with her at the table, and we were all sitting there waiting, and we didn't know what was going to happen, and then Deb won the award for Best Actor and Benita was sitting with her, and they just embraced. But they wouldn't stop embracing, and like the crowd's clapping and the minutes are ticking by and it's all on television and they're still embracing and they're crying, and it was wonderful. And then, you know, Benita and Deb got up on stage together, and I just think for Deb, that must have been just a crowning special moment in her career. So I think, look, for us as filmmakers, it was extraordinary having Benita with us to advise us. And Charles Passy, who was the other claimant's son. But for Deb Mailman, who was playing the role of Benita, it was even more significant, I think.
Well, your films and docos, including The First Australians, Mabo, Freedom Rider and Redfern Now, are strong stories about Australia's history and people. How important are these films and docos in building a platform for greater understanding between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people?
I think film can be a really powerful force in bringing people together, because when you see a film or you hear a story, if it's well told, you can put yourself in the shoes of that person whose story it is. You can imagine being them. You see the story through their eyes. And so I think for other Australians to be put in the shoes of Indigenous Australians and see our story through our eyes, that's a very potent tool in making them see things from our perspective. So, you know, we've used it historically as a tool for understanding, and now we're using it, you know, as a cultural expression that reaches millions of people, like The Sapphires. You know, it's the biggest Australian film of last year, and that's just had a huge impact. So I think, you know, good cinema, good storytelling at its best can bring greater understanding, it can create pride in Indigenous people, they're seeing themselves on screen, and it can maintain and, you know, be a conduit for our continuing evolving culture, I suppose.
Indigenous Australians and their culture, the oldest on the planet, have had to fight a long battle to walk the free steps of their ancestors before colonisation in 1788. They've endured a long fight for their human rights, equal rights, and the right to claim their own land. Rachel's late father, Charles Perkins, the first Indigenous Australian to graduate from university, was one of the most prominent Aboriginal leaders of our time, striving for the advancement of his people. In 1965, he organised a group of 30 university students from Sydney to travel to country New South Wales on a campaign famously known as the Freedom Ride to protest against racial discrimination and poor living conditions.
You know, you couldn't go into pools, you couldn't go into bars, you couldn't get a hotel room if you were Aboriginal. There were curfews in town, you had to be out of town by a certain time. My father grew up having to walk on the road, not on the footpath, you know, so those sorts of experiences for that generation really affected them, you know, and affected the way they saw their country, you know, growing up as a young man as my father did in a segregated environment. And I thought, well, we need to know that story. You know, we can't pretend that that didn't happen. Just because there were no signs, you know, just because apartheid wasn't our official policy, it happened. And, you know, you can't move forward until you embrace what we have.
Well, I think like Dad, she has, you know, Rachel has the fire in her belly. You know, I think it burns in her, that the injustice of the past. And I think that's something that, you know, my generation or our generation and, you know, generations before us also have inherited, this kind of feeling that, you know, as my father said, our father said, we know we cannot live in the past, but the past lives in us. And I think that's something that Rachel feels very keenly. And I feel that she feels that through the medium of film, you know, through television, through the kind of audiences that medium can reach, that she can actually potentially change the culture of the way people think about our history, think about our contemporary reality, and indeed think about us as people.
The Freedom Ride protesters drew parallels with the civil rights movements of the 1960s from around the world, especially the United States, where Martin Luther King was leading the fight for equality.
Skin may differ, but affection dwells in black and white the same.
And back in Australia, the news coverage of the Freedom Ride campaign hit a raw nerve.
The only good ones are dead ones.
What, all the Aborigines?
Every one of them.
They're the ones that caused the trouble in this town.
Run them out and they'll be
put them out of town.
The Freedom Ride protest is embedded in Australia's history, and it made an impact on the young Rachel Perkins, who drew on her knowledge of that time to release her first major film documentary in 1993.
I'd grown up knowing the Freedom Ride because, of course, you know, it was my dad who was on it with a bunch of other Australians and Indigenous people involved, and it was such a part of my understanding of what the country was like. But none of my friends knew that Australia was a segregated place. They had no idea. You know, they think, oh, South Africa, it's really bad over there, and oh, it's terrible what happened in these other countries. And I thought, how can they not know that, you know, Australia was, until very recent times, segregated? You know, Germans have done really well in embracing their history and what happened in the war. Australia is still trying to deny it. You know, the war memorial won't even recognise that there were battles fought across the country in a war. So we need these stories. We need to bring them. We need to understand them, accept what they were, accept what happened, and then move forward. Because otherwise, Indigenous people resent that this history has been covered up, and non-Indigenous people don't understand how we feel about the country. So I think that's the great power of storytelling, and filmmaking is a very effective way of getting those stories to millions of people. You can tell your story, and in telling that story, there's some sort of resolution. You know, I've experienced that myself. I felt like after doing First Australians, you know, some of those burning things that I felt upset about that had happened to our people, that felt resolved inside of me, because I felt like I'd been a part of telling that story and putting it out there for people. And I think other Indigenous people who I've worked with who told that story felt that way themselves. So I think storytelling can be a powerful force.
And Rachel experienced the power of storytelling growing up in a household of leaders, her activist father and mother Eileen playing a major role in her drive to make a difference.
She realise, like Dad, the one thing that they share very common is this understanding of how to get the message out. What is the most effective means to get the message out? And I think Dad used to always say things like, well, you know, someone's got to be the radical. Because the radical, everyone, you know, people listen to it and, you know, that kind of breaks new ground, and then the kind of more reasoned people can come along and make the changes that need to happen. But, you know, it's how do you get the message out there? How do you gather, how do you garner attention for your cause? And I think that's something that both Rachel and Dad understand very, very clearly. And Rachel, I think, has found that being on, controlling the camera, if you like, is a very powerful position.
In 1980, Indigenous Australia found a voice through the Central Australian Aboriginal Media Association. And this is where Rachel's journey and passion for filmmaking and storytelling was ignited.
No one was interested in Indigenous film and television. You know, a small group of, you know, Aboriginal people were, obviously Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people were, very interested in it. You know, they wanted to see Indigenous stories, but, you know, the broadcasters and the people who controlled film distribution were not interested. And the pervading perception was that anything with Aboriginal people in it won't rate. There was this saying, blacks don't rate, mate. And so we had a battle to, you know, fight for space on the networks. And, you know, some people were happy to give us, you know, a small moment on, you know, their very full schedules, but it was a struggle. But people had struggled before us, and so when I was 18, you know, there'd already been this activism for the self-representation of Indigenous Australians by themselves, and it had grown out of the self-determination movement that really came out of, you know, black power in the 70s, black people all over the world deciding that they wanted to be in charge of their own destinies, that they wanted to run their own affairs, that their images of themselves they wanted to be proud of, that they wanted to be in control of their destinies. You know, now we're making feature films that are kicking well above their weight and are going out there in the world and being, making Australia internationally recognised, and Indigenous people, of course, recognised through being in those films. So it's a great time now to be an Indigenous filmmaker in the country. Now we have our own television service, and audiences are saying, we want to see Indigenous stories. It's part of our, and we enjoy them. And we're not all racist rednecks, actually. We do want to see them. So it's just gone from sort of, we don't want to know about you, and we don't want to give you any money, and we don't want to make your films, to what's your next project? You know, can we make something with you? So that's a great thing, and it's been achieved through activism on the one hand, and being good at what you do has got to go together. Those things have gone together, and we've got now a really good balance between that, and I can just see growth in the future.
Inspired by her father and the African American film movement, Rachel was driven to share the true history of Australia through her landmark documentary series, First Australians, which took close to 6 years to make.
It really told the story of colonisation and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders' response to it from sort of 1788 through to 1993 with the Mabo legislation. And it was an enormous task, and I felt like if there was anything that I was sort of put on the planet to do, it was do that series, you know. And it was an opportunity to really tell a comprehensive story of what happened in Australia from the perspective of Indigenous people who were there at the time. So the expectation was very high. Our people, I felt like our people were standing behind us, you know, wanting us to get this story across, and they believed in us to give their stories to us, you know, like to tell the Mabo story is a great honour, to tell the story of William Burruck, it's a fantastic, you know, story, amazing story, to tell the story of Bennelong and Wingerdine, you know, these Indigenous heroes who changed the course of our history. It was pretty scary to take on such important stories, but you know, one of my great privileges to be involved in doing that.
What sort of an impact do you think it had in creating a better understanding amongst all Australians in terms of, you know, our history and our culture?
A common response we had to First Australians when, you know, other Australians would come up to us and they'd tell us that they'd seen it. They said things like, why weren't we told? You know, why didn't we know about William Barak and his people and his land rights struggle, you know, in the 1850s and 60s and 70s and 80s, you know, it went for a long time, his struggle. Why weren't we told that? You know, why didn't we know about Wingerdine and Pemulwuy and Bennelong? You know, and it's their right. It's all Australians' right to know their history and to build a national identity on a history that contains both the Indigenous, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander culture and the occupational culture that came afterwards. And that it is very much a shared history. And I think that First Australians perhaps contributed to building a fuller narrative about Australia. Like we don't just have to know about the Gold Rush, you know. We don't have to just know about Ned Kelly. You know, there's a bigger story to be told. There's a bigger Indigenous story. Our lives are entwined. Indigenous and European and other Australian lives are entwined in this country. And First Australians was about telling that story of how we related to each other, what happened in this country, and looking back at the past so we can think about, well, that's what happened then, how can we do it better in the future? Hopefully First Australians, and we know it did because it's gone into most schools in Australia, will be giving young Australians a different view of their country, how it was founded, who was there at the time, how Indigenous and non-Indigenous people responded to each other in those circumstances.
Yeah, I remember, you know, going to school myself, just learning about Captain Cook discovered this country. We need to, you know, be getting into the schools and teaching kids from an early age the real history of this country.
Yeah, and I think if you look at a country like New Zealand, and they had the Treaty of Waitangi, and so they had a stronger basis than we've ever had for some sort of recognition of their share of the country, their rights in the country. You know, it took until, you know, Mabo, and it's still evolving today, to really recognise Indigenous people. But I think the great thing is that there's this amazing heritage. Like up here at Gama, you know, the Yolngu people said, you know, we can stand together. Our strength is your strength. You know, our story is your story. We have something to give to Australia. We are Yolngu people, but we are Australians. And that's the case with Indigenous Australians. We have something to give the rest of the country. Make Indigenous heritage part of their identity. Make them proud of it. Make them understand it and embrace it, like they have to some degree in other countries like Aotearoa, New Zealand.
During the 1890s, Australia's First Peoples were excluded from discussions about the creation of a new nation. Passed in 1900, the Constitution came into effect on January 1, 1901, without any recognition of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. At the time, they were considered a dying race, not worthy of citizenship or humanity. There are now strong calls to recognise Indigenous Australians in the Constitution.
Indigenous people need to be embraced in a equal, non-racist way in the Constitution. And I follow our leaders, people like Noel Pearson and Marcia Langton, who have led the debate on this. And I think it doesn't undermine our sovereignty. We are Australians. We are under the common Constitution. It is time for the recognition to happen.
Through making your own films and docos, do you see that as a form of your own activism?
Yeah, I think it's a really powerful form of activism in a way. It's like activism in Indigenous Australia has sort of changed. Like, we used to be out on the streets a lot, marching and protesting, and now we've sort of infiltrated government, infiltrated the arts, and we're using those springboards to be activists. And in a way, I feel like I'm a cultural activist. Someone described, Stephen Page said, you're a cultural shield. You know, you're in the business to express culture, maintain history, communicate stories, change thinking, affect people emotionally, change the way they think about their country, change the way they think about land rights, you know, change the way they think about native title. So those things are political aspirations, and they are an extension of activism. So yeah, I would like to think I'm an activist.
Now more than ever, Indigenous Australia is at the forefront in all facets of Australian society. And Rachel's current works have portrayed a deeper understanding of contemporary urban life for Aboriginal Australia.
Yeah, people have really connected with Redfern now. I don't know why exactly, they just love it. I think they love it. Well, it's good drama, it's entertaining, and that's fundamental. Like, the stories have got to be well told. And the Redfern community were really happy with it. So that's always a great thing. You know, like, they're tough Redfern mob, and they've been mistreated, misrepresented. So we really wanted to do a good job and make sure that they were happy with the outcome.
And while Rachel shines the light on the stories of Indigenous Australia, she's determined to continue the tradition of her ancestors.
And I'm certainly continuing standing on the shoulders of other activists, people who were really fighting in a much more difficult time, in an era when people weren't interested in Indigenous Australia, you know. But still, we're still on a political path that is a continuum, I think, from the very past when people first arrive. It's a continual struggle to maintain our culture and tell our stories and keep that going into the future. So it is a long line of activism, and it will continue when we've retired, Carla.